It's live, it's not crime fiction, it's for real.
And it's you that makes it work. On Crimewatch tonight...
A 27-year-old mystery, the double murder in Wales that rocked the country. And there's a DNA profile that could now point to the killer.
Search! There's another one here!
The bungling young robbers who, in their panic to escape, almost killed a woman driving past.
The truck driver caught on CCTV who hit a scooter rider and callously drove on.
And he set off on his bike and waved at the bottom of the road like this. Could see his hand going. And that was the last story. But at least I give him a kiss, ta-ra.
And the bogus builders who stole a pensioner's life savings of £16,000.
You may be watching this live, or you might be watching this segment on a video at a community centre, a school or a youth club. Because this part of the programme is going to be used in a concerted campaign to get at a group of boys who might very well not watch Crimewatch Live. They're involved in a murder which affected the whole nation back in November.
Police are hunting for the killers of a 10-year-old boy who was stabbed to death.
He dragged himself 100 yards to escape his attacker.
I feel sorry for his parents, I really do.
The family of 10-year-old Damilola left the scene of the murder.
Shock and outrage, not just in this house, but right across the country.
I mean, look at the boy there, his innocent little face. How could anyone do that to him?
He was found slumped at the bottom of this stairwell.
This has long been a notorious estate, but many felt that it was just beginning to turn the corner.
Somebody, somewhere, knows something. And for some reason, is sheltering the perpetrators of this crime.
Scotland Yard said they would continue the high-profile operation. His parents decided a memorial service was the only way to remember his life and mourn his death. His brother delivered the tribute.
The only thing I did not offer him was protection from his killers on that fateful day. Damilola, I know you are resting peacefully in the Lord's arms. Please forgive me for not being there for you.
Well, after all that, how can we get people to come forward now? We'll take a look at this. Damilola's mother, Gloria, his father, Richard, and his brother, Tunde, helped us to retell the events leading up to his death.
Lagos, capital of Nigeria, where Damilola's family lived and his father was a civil servant. Damilola's sister, Bemi, was born in London, but in Lagos, her epilepsy became so dangerous, the family decided to bring her back.
We had problems with obtaining drugs. This was as a result of shortages. So we decided if we cannot get drugs and we cannot continue to see her suffer, we had to take a decision. So we held a meeting amongst the family and we decided that, well, Bemi has to go back.
As a temporary measure, the family went to live with Damilola's great aunt on the North Peckham estate. Mr. Taylor's job meant he had to stay in Nigeria. Damilola was enrolled into a local school.
He had this ambition of studying medicine so that he can get a cure for the sister's ailment. When the sister goes into fit, he's always there to take care of her, you know, to comfort her. And whenever she comes around, he's always there. You know, he's such a talented boy. He was very talented.
It's a boy that cares. And he's always concerned about everybody's welfare.
On Monday morning, Damilola left home for school as usual, wearing his silver puffer jacket. He often walked with friends, but after school he was on his own when he went to the library on Peckham High Street.
I mean, you could see him in the CCTV footage, going running off down to the library with no care in the world, just jumping. That's the way his life has always been.
Damilola loved the library because of the computers and met friends here. No doubt other kids were hanging out here too, maybe in the music section. Do you remember someone being picked on? Damilola seemed happy enough when he left at around 4:30 and played briefly with two other children. What's now important is if you know where he went from here, the swimming pool car park next to the library. Think back. What were you doing on the day Damilola died? Did you see anything that could explain which route he took? If you saw anyone else at around 4:30 or 4:45 that Monday afternoon between the library and Blake's Road, please give us a call.
I was passing along Blake's Road. It was getting dark. It was a bit chilly as well. I saw a patch on the floor, which I thought it was a squashed tomato. When I went a bit further, I saw another patch which was larger, and I realised it was blood. I kept following the blood to see what was going on. He went up the stairs of the block of flats. I saw this boy, which he made eye contact with me. You know, he was like, help me quick, be with me. And I realised he was hurt. Blood was running through his leg. It was horrible.
The attack probably took place on Blake's Road itself. It's a fairly busy street, and there must have been others about. Over 600 people have already come forward to give statements. If you were around and haven't yet helped, now is the time to do it. Maybe whoever stabbed Damilola only meant to mark him, but the blade severed Damilola's artery, and by the time he'd made his way into the stairwell, he was virtually beyond help. One of the many people who visited the scene and now joins the appeal is one of Radio 1's dream team, DJ Spoonie.
You know, if it was you or one of your friends that has done this, I know, you know, respect from your friends, from the rest of the boys, you know, in your gang, in your crew, on the estate is all important. I was one of those people. But, you know, something like this deserves no respect whatsoever. OK, it's happened now. We can't change the fact that it's happened now. If you are going to earn any respect at all, it will be to come forward, whether you're the person that did it or you know who did it. Someone knows, because not a lot went on when I was growing up on the estate without you knowing who did it or no sign to know who did it. So we're just asking you to please come forward for Damilola and for Damilola's family.
I never expected such thing to have happened to such a lovely boy. Having even spoken to him that Saturday, I never knew I was talking to him for the last time.
The only memory I have of him now is that I just see him smiling. That's it. See him smiling all the time. That's all I can ever think of him, smiling.
Oh, Trevor's just so desperately, desperately sad. Are you any closer to catching Damilola's killers?
I've got a lot of information in the inquiry which is telling me that those responsible are probably a group of young people, not much older than Damilola himself. I believe that the injury that actually caused Damilola's death was probably inflicted by a single member of that group. And whilst I'm conducting a murder inquiry, I am alive to the possibility that Damilola's death could have been unintentional.
If one of the gang who was there, who didn't actually do it, but saw what happened, if one of them comes forward to you now, they're going to get into a lot of trouble, aren't they?
Somebody who saw the incident, didn't take part, is a witness, and a witness that we desperately need to speak to. And I would appeal to members of the family of that individual who are probably well aware of what happened and could well be under a lot of pressure. Please come forward. I would say to the young person involved, you must come forward. You need to tell us what happened. And you need to get this off your chest at an early opportunity.
Now, if you're going to treat that person as a witness, can you protect them?
Absolutely, and I'll give an undertaking here and now that anyone that comes forward as a witness and fears that they may be intimidated or members of their family may suffer as a result of talking to us, we will protect them, and I can give an undertaking.
So even if they were in the gang, they saw what happened, you will treat them as a witness. What if they don't come forward?
Well, what I would say then is they would leave me with no alternative but to believe that they were in some way involved with Damilola's death. I would say to them, we're not going away. We're going to keep coming. We're going to keep coming back to the estate. We will catch these individuals. And if they don't come forward, they can find themselves in an awful lot of trouble.
OK, Trevor, well, you heard it there. Come forward. It's going to be a lot, lot worse for you if you don't. The number to call is 0500 600 600 here to the studio. And there are other detectives standing by in the incident room. That's on 020 8247 4567.
Individual calls really do make such a difference. Since last month, there have been 13 arrests on Crimewatch appeals, 11 because of calls here to Crimewatch, and so far, 4 convictions. Paul Sargent pleaded guilty to grievous bodily harm. After a viewer recognised him on Crimewatch, he tried to rob an old man in Lincoln and beat him semi-conscious with a snooker cue. Paul Sargent was given probation. Remember this, a firebomb thrown through the door of a nightclub in Doncaster. Two suspects walking around the town were named by Crimewatch viewers as Paul McKenzie and Mark Jackson. They've been sentenced to 6 and 5 years, respectively. And we call this man Bungalow Bill because he was wanted for stealing from bungalows at a holiday park in Cornwall. A viewer in Cumbria recognised him as Timothy Killick from Essex, who's been sentenced to 2.5 years. It's 6 months since the murder of little Sarah Payne. The head of Sussex CID is one of my colleagues here on Crime Watch, and tonight, on the basis of new evidence, he has an important new appeal.
Thanks, Nick. Now, I had a great response from Crime Watch on the last occasion, but if we can crack this, then it could prove absolutely crucial. Now, we've recovered this curtain, which holds vital clues, and we need to know where it came from. It's about 5 foot wide by 6 foot tall and looks hand-stitched, so it's probably homemade. Now, I need help in three distinct areas. Did you make the curtain or did you own it? Was there more than one made or is it one of a pair? And if so, where's the other one? And most importantly, I need to know where the actual material was manufactured. Take another look at it. I believe this may prove to be a vital piece of evidence which will help convict Sarah's killer. Someone in the textile industry must recognise the design. I've got detectives waiting for your call. 0845 60 70 999.
The biggest murder inquiry ever in Wales. 30,000 people were interviewed. But that was in 1973, and still the case is charged with grief and remains unsolved. There were lots of suspects at the time, and several people watching Crime Watch tonight will certainly have their own hunches. In fact, someone might even know who did it. So here with new evidence is the reopened file on Geraldine Hughes and Pauline Floyd.
The area they were found, I passed that area 18 times a week. And it'll never, ever go from my mind. Never, ever.
Consul 1 from Sergeant Jones. We discovered the body of a young girl in Llandarcy Woods.
567 control, could you arrange some tape? We need to cordon off the area.
We can imagine what they went through. They must have been terrified.
Sarge! There's another one here!
We live that every day of our lives. To think what them two girls went through. And that is the nightmare. Constant nightmare, night after night.
Geraldine was very bubbly, very lively. She loved her dogs and her cats and her rabbits. Pauline was quieter. She was very small, like a little doll.
She always used to have these the freckles, which she always used to say, why did I have freckles? And she, you know, she used to try and wipe them off sometimes, but they were so many.
On the night of the murders, the girls arranged to meet outside the Smith's Arms pub in Neath Abbey, and from there they planned to travel into Swansea.
I was going to go with Geraldine and Pauline to Swansea, but because I'd started a new job, I didn't have much money, so I just didn't go.
That Saturday was the day of the annual Neath Fair, and all the buses travelling back to Swansea were full.
It's going to be hours before we get one now.
It's three now.
It wasn't unusual to hitchhike. It was the thing that was done, and he wasn't afraid to do it. We thumbed lifts, and a lot of other girls of our age thumbed lifts at that time.
Oh, thanks for stopping. Do you want a lift, girls?
Going up?
Top rank in Swansea. We would do that at 8:30. What are you doing here then?
I was picking some people up from a wedding in Swansea about midnight. Just driving up, what's the time really? Not to wreck me or girls. I'm a stranger in these parts, up in the valley, see?
The driver of that minibus was never traced, but if he has any recollection of the journey all those years ago, his evidence might now make all the difference. Once in Swansea, the girls went to what was then the top rank on Kingsway.
We used to dance all night. Our feet would be aching at the end of the evening. We used to thoroughly enjoy the dancing. Mark Bolan was our hero at the time.
By the time the club closed at 1 a.m, Pauline and Geraldine had missed their last bus home. So they decided to hitchhike back to Llandarsi, where Geraldine lived. Many people said they'd seen Geraldine and Pauline getting into a light-coloured car, possibly an Austin or Morris 1100. Did you see them, or were you the driver that gave them a lift?
Two bubbly girls, aren't they? Enjoying life. Just starting out fashion and all this.
This was the last known sighting of Pauline and Geraldine alive. But a light-coloured car was later seen over a half-hour period next to the copse where the girls were later found. Was it innocently parked here by someone who was too frightened to come forward at the time? The copse is only half a mile from Geraldine's home. Maybe the girls asked to be dropped off here so that they could take a shortcut back to the house.
Over here is the spot where the body of Pauline was found, and it's clear from the forensic evidence and the examination of the scene that at some stage, both Pauline and Geraldine were together at this spot when they were attacked. The evidence suggests then that Geraldine has attempted to run through the copse and has almost made it to the main road. Sadly, within yards of the roadway, the killer has caught her and dragged her back into the wood, where he has then attacked her. Both Geraldine and Pauline were strangled with ligatures, struck on the back of the head, and were sexually assaulted during the attack.
The things that they have missed out on, that I have had myself. I've got children and grandchildren, and it's just what they have missed.
It's taken its toll on both families and especially for our father. He's 87 now. And that's his only wish after it happened, that he'd live. For him to know the name of the person, you know, responsible.
Paul, it's desperately sad, but it horrified people at the time. And if they haven't come forward over the last 27 years, why should they come forward now?
Yes, there is an old adage, Nick, that time is a great healer. But having spoken to the families, I can tell you that they remain as devastated and broken-hearted now as they were 27 years ago. But there may be men out there that were spoken to at the time and may feel that they are suspected of the offence or might have been suspected of the offence. And I would ask them now to come forward. We can now eliminate them from the inquiry.
Very simple elimination with a swab.
Five minutes with a cotton swab.
What about people who had suspicions at the time?
There will be no recriminations. There might be people out there that gave false alibis at the times to possibly brothers, husbands, sons. We would ask them now to search their conscience and come forward and give us a name. That's all we need.
And even if people didn't do anything like give a false alibi, they just had, I'm not sure about so-and-so. I mean, they might not have come forward because they don't want to get so-and-so into trouble on what's nothing more than suspicion. But now that suspicion's important because you can eliminate it.
Absolutely, we can eliminate. We don't need to ask questions as such. It's a simple procedure. Just please come forward and tell us anything you know about these killings.
Now, these two murders are bad enough, but there's a possibility. I know you haven't formally linked them. There's a possibility that they are linked to a series of rapes where ligatures were used as well in a sort of 10-mile area of where this happened.
Yes, there were two other quite brutal attacks with the use of ligatures. And what I would ask, Nick, is if there are any young women of the time out there that possibly
1972, 1973,
that were possibly attacked or approached by a man in a manner that might have caused them some concern, please contact
not
us.
Not just in Llandarsi, but anywhere around Swansea?
Within about a 10-mile radius of the murder scene. I'd ask those women to contact us now. They may hold vital information.
But please, if there's anything you know at all, any suspicions you've got, and you've heard, even if you gave a false alibi, it doesn't matter now. Just please call, and the DNA swab is so simple, so quick for elimination. The studio number is 0500 600 600. The incident room is on 01 639 889 127. Or you can email us at crimewatchuk, that's CWUK at bbc.co.uk.
And coming up later, another case that's remained unsolved for 2 decades. The deaths of 13 teenagers in a house fire in New Cross in London. Now on the 20th anniversary, the police launch a fresh appeal and offer their biggest reward ever.
Smash and grabs now, or in one case, just grab. Who is this in West Byfleet in Surrey last September? He ran out of the store with a stolen eternity ring. Or who's this? He's been crashing literally through windows in London's West End. Now, could this be the same person on a different occasion? And who's the man with the paving slab in Westbourne in West Sussex? This is one of several attacks on the same store. Call the studio on 0500 600 600.
How good are you at remembering faces? This one, for example. Benjamin Antwi is wanted after a colleague of his was attacked with a bow saw and terribly injured. Or Peter Thomas O'Toole, who jumped over the dock and escaped from a court as he was being tried for a savage attack on a boy in a chip shop. And Paul Atkinson is suspected of attacking his wife with a kitchen knife. His 4-year-old son was in the room at the time. Now, these are very violent crimes. Help us find them. 0500 600 600.
Coming up, the scooter rider knocked over by a lorry, hit by a dozen vehicles and killed. The truck driver wrenched the scooter wreckage from his cab and drove away. Please help find him. And the biggest ever hunt in Britain for a serial rapist. For 10 years, he's escaped detection.
Take your safety belt off. Don't move or slash your face.
Tonight, we have a new and potentially powerful clue.
If you were planning a robbery with a getaway car, you think you'd at least make sure you knew where it was parked and where you were going to go in it. A gang who robbed the Bristol and West in Winchester seemed to have been a pretty clueless bunch, though their bungling nearly killed an innocent motorist.
Vehicle's now 115 miles an hour, approaching slow moving traffic again. He's still swerving between the lanes, deliberately attempting to block those helicopter being thrown from the vehicle. Head shot.
It's the worst driving I've ever seen on the motorway, and it was certainly the most dangerous driving I've ever seen. He was going at a horrendous speed when he came off the motorway. We know he went through a red light at the top of the slip road, straight onto the roundabout, and collided with a member of the public.
The blue 3 Series BMW had been stolen from Shepherd's Bush, West London, 10 weeks earlier. Then, in December, it appeared in Winchester, Hampshire, and parked in St. Peter Street near the town centre. The driver stayed with the car while his 4 passengers walked towards the High Street.
Actually knew the area very well because they appeared to run past the alleyways, which they should have run down straight away. Running down the alleyway next to Champion Sport.
Yeah, we'll do it. Keep me updated.
Flight control, police 8.
Police 8, okay.
Across St George's Street into St Peter's Street. One of them appeared to mess around and play with his sock and stop and drop behind the rest of them.
Maybe he'd stuffed money down his trousers and it was falling out.
They appeared to get into the wrong vehicle to start with. They got into the car that was at the front.
Eventually they found the right car, but there was more of their bungling to come.
Yeah, Roger. Tango 1, Oscar Bravo, can you get a registration?
Unfortunately, no.
But a police officer knew which route they'd need to take and got their number. Winchester has a complicated one-way system, and the escape car had to pass the police station. An officer spotted it and pulled out to follow. Once on the M3, a traffic car took over in pursuit.
Still failing to stop, swerving between lanes 1, 2 and 3. Crewe Junction 8, further property being thrown from the vehicle, still straddling the two lines, 110.
There was nothing other than luck that prevented a serious accident that night on the motorway. And in the rush hour traffic, serious injury or even lives could have been lost with that sort of driving.
It happened anyway. For safety's sake, the officer deliberately let them get away. But coming off the M3, they went straight across red lights.
There's a balance between the need to get hold of these guys who'd committed the offence in Winchester, but also there has to be a priority, and the priority has to be the member of the public who's just been injured.
The motorist they'd hit was unconscious, and she was seriously hurt. In the town of Hook, not far from the crash site, a security guard noticed three youths in the company car park.
Oi, what you doing?
We're just taking a shortcut. We ain't been up to nothing.
He remembers one had a cut on his forehead.
Where can I get a car from?
A car? What do you mean a car?
Taxi. Where can I get a taxi?
I couldn't tell you, mate.
Can you tell me the way to a taxi rank? I need to get a taxi.
Do you remember being approached in Tesco's car park by an agitated young man? Or did you see the youths inside the store on Monday, December the 11th?
Capital Cars.
I need a cab. London.
To London from Tesco's? Yeah, no, sorry, I've got nothing free. All right. I thought it was a hoax. We've never had a call from Tesco's to go to London, obviously because it's next to the station. And it sounded like kids. The voices were just too young.
Sometime later, three youths were seen just outside the station. There'd been a landslide, so there were no trains to London. Did you see them go by train to Basingstoke instead? Or do you remember giving them a lift? Because from here, they appear to vanish. Considering how disorganised they were, it's amazing they managed to get away. Call 0845 045 4545. And if you want to give information anonymously on this or any other crime, you can call Crime Stoppers on 0800 555 111.
Remember the London nail bomber? He killed and terribly injured people in Brick Lane, Soho and Brixton. Well, David Copeland is now in jail for life. But a quite different cache of even more deadly bombs has been discovered. Who's manufacturing them and why? If we can't find who's making them, a lot more people could well lose their lives. This is Syreford near Cheltenham in Gloucestershire, and the bomb discovered here is by any means seriously sophisticated. It was found by a gamekeeper in August. It had been primed but hadn't gone off. It was flanked by two MDF boards, which would have measured the impact of the bomb. 3 days later, in the village of Freeland in Oxfordshire, eight more bombs were discovered, this time by a man walking his dog. They'd been buried in woods that border the village. Whoever made these bombs has a real knowledge of electrical engineering. They really are very, very sophisticated indeed. This isn't one of the originals, this is a replica, and the reason for that is the originals were booby-trapped, certainly the radio control ones were, with a sophisticated mercury tilt device. And whoever hid them is quite likely to have had a military training, or at any rate some real orienteering skills, so that he could find his way back to his hidden hoard of bombs. The design of this isn't known in any other form of bomb that's been used by the terrorist movements in the United Kingdom or by anybody in the United States or anyone in Europe. This is truly original. It's very, very sophisticated indeed. In fact, it's almost so obsessional, Ewan. One wonders, did the guy really want to kill people? Is he a psychopath or is he just really trying to prove himself.
It's difficult to say. I mean, we just don't know. But what we do know, as you said, it's wholly unique. A lot of time's been spent. He's been most meticulous. So we think the sort of person who would have been involved in this is somebody who's got technical skills, possibly a craftsman, a modeler, more likely to be somebody who's got weapons or explosives training, but certainly a good knowledge of electronics.
Somebody that people will know as an expert in this sort of thing. It's not something he'd be able to disguise.
Difficult to disguise, high level of expertise, certainly, yes.
And hard for him to disguise these. This is a compression, a 28mm compression stop end. It's used in plumbing, and he's used a lot of these in these bombs. Now tell us, you've had an appeal out on this because he had to buy so many of them.
We have. They're fairly unusual. They're 28mm brass compression stop ends used in plumbing, but generally used only for heavy duty plumbing.
And most shops would only have a few of these.
Absolutely. He bought, we're trying to eliminate somebody who bought 32 all in one lot from Marston Road Plumbing Store in Oxford about a month before the Oxfordshire bombs were found.
32. Now, in the 9 bombs you found, that accounts for 18, 14 left, so there could be 7 more bombs out there.
There may well be, I'm afraid.
The man who bought these said that he wanted them for furniture. He was a tall guy, 6 foot two.
He was tall, 6 foot 2 and slim, with brown curly hair, wearing a brown sweater.
Now, you've bought a toy car, which is a remote-controlled one. Actually, it's a toy van on one side, isn't it? And then a toy car on the other.
Yes.
What's the significance of that?
The 3 of the devices were remote-controlled devices, and the remote control mechanisms were actually taken from a car identical to this.
So if somebody's seen one of these cannibalised and it fits with the sort of person who could possibly make one of these,
yes,
you want to know.
Please.
And the sort of description, well, possibly the tall man, that you want to eliminate that from the shop in Oxford. The other possibility is a man seen in Salford in Gloucestershire where the bomb was found.
Yes, exactly. This man was seen in precisely the right spot a few hours before the bomb was actually found, the evening before.
What does he look like?
He's described mid-40s with a full beard and sort of greying hair, wearing a blue hiking jacket.
Mid-40s with a big beard. Think, I mean, do you know anybody like that? Anybody with a fascination with bombs? An obsession or perhaps a hatred enough to make them or even use them? If so, I mean, really, you can't take a chance on this one. Who are you thinking of? What's the name? Please give us a call. Let the police eliminate them from the inquiry. It's a free call to 0500 600 600 or 01865 335252.
Three armed robbers now. First, could this be your granny? She was in Norwich last month wielding a handgun, believe it or not. Now, she seems to be in her early 60s. We call this one the sunglasses robber. He's in Greenford in West London, but this was back last May. The shades aren't much of a disguise, so tell us who he is. And if you've heard the expression dying for a fag, well, here's a man threatening to kill for one. He's in an off-licence in Farnham Common in Buckinghamshire 2 months ago, demanding cash and, yes, cigarettes. Recognise the dirty, matted hair stuffed under that baseball cap? 0500 600 600.
A week before Christmas, a body was seen on the shore of the Thames at Battersea in London. It turned out to be the victim of a murder, 24-year-old Zoe Parker. Someone had cut her in half at the waist. Zoe never really had a chance. She had some learning difficulties, had been brought up in care and led a chaotic hand-to-mouth existence. She travelled all over the country, often staying in squats or B&Bs, though occasionally she took accommodation or money in return for sex. But she craved attention and often spoke to strangers. She used several names, for example, Kathy Dennis, and kept her entire life in this haversack. And where is it? And where are the boots she always wore? And who are the two people with Zoe in this photo? And where was she staying at the beginning of December? 0500 600 600 or 020 8247 7911.
We've had a lot of calls on the murder of little Damilola Taylor. A lot of calls from people on the estate, very encouragingly, with some interesting names. No one's yet come forward who was there, who was part of that gang. Remember, if you come forward, you'll be treated as a witness, you'll be given protection. Give us a call.
Remember October last year and the storms? Gales lashed the whole of Britain. And before dawn, on Monday the 30th of October, it really wasn't a great time to be on the roads. But high winds and driving rain really weren't the biggest problem on the M40 near Warwick. A lorry driver rammed a motorcyclist from behind and then drove on. Ron Cobbledick was killed. He'd been riding from his home in Lancashire all the way down to Slough in Berkshire, where he spent his working week.
We were married for 13 years last July. Well, I met him at work. We both worked at the same factory. We made up our minds on the Monday, got the licence on the Tuesday, and got married on the Thursday in the lunch break. Had a bacon butty first. And then went and got married. It was just like us, just impulsive, like. With the weather being bad and everything and changing the clocks and that, he set off at 3 that morning and he always checked everything on his bike and he switched everything on, indicators, and give him a kiss and a cuddle, wrapped him up in with his scarf, put the scarf around him. I always stood on the doorstep in my dressing gown, and, waving him off. I'll see you next week. Right, ring me up as soon as you get there, won't you? Yes, promise. And he set off on his bike and waved at the bottom of the road like this. See his hand going on. And that was it. That was the last I saw of him. But at least I gave him a kiss to her and waved him off, didn't I?
Ron's 5-hour journey took him down the M42 until just after 6 a.m. he joined the M40 at junction 3A, and here he is in the near side lane heading south. Moments later, this Volvo FL7 or FL10 came down the M40 in the middle lane. At maybe 50 miles an hour, the lorry moved into the near side lane, where, in bad conditions, Ron was doing 35. The truck hit the scooter from behind, throwing Ron into the air and trapping the wreckage underneath the cab. Ron was then hit by maybe a dozen vehicles. The truck driver stopped on the hard shoulder, but instead of running back to see what he could do, he made a phone call, he dragged the bike remains from underneath the lorry, then continued on his journey. Take another look at the lorry, driving south on the M40 early Monday morning, the 30th of October, a red and blue Volvo F7 or F10 with an illuminated sign or lights on the front grille.
You know, I'm thinking, Joe, I haven't rung me, he must be late, he's got stuck in traffic. But then, about 10:30, a policeman come to the door. He just said, Audrey Cobbledick. And I said, yeah. He says, please, can I come in? I said, no, you can't. No, I don't want to know, don't go. I just pushed, just wouldn't let him in. I just wouldn't let him come through the door. He said, I've got to come in, so I let him in. He says, sit down. I said, no, I'm not sitting down, I'm not sitting down. In my mind, I'm thinking, if I don't let him in, he's not going to tell me. If I don't sit down, he's not going to tell me, but I knew.
Who drove that truck? It's a red and blue, an F7 or F10, and lights on the front grille, heading away south on the M40 early on a Monday morning last October. Please, please call us. Or call 01926 415 257.
If you live in Peterborough, you must know about the rape last month in Paston. It's had huge publicity locally, but maybe you haven't realised how you can help. It's the simplest thing. Please give us a call if you were in the local spa shop in Welland Road between 5 and 8 o'clock on that evening. If you haven't heard what happened, let me just say that a 16-year-old girl was hit on the head until she was in a coma and then raped.
My daughter left the house just before a few minutes to 6 to go up to the spa to get her money out. She probably thought nothing of walking up there, being as it was that early. And on the way back, some vicious thug attacked my daughter.
Police are anxious to trace an Afro-Caribbean man who approached two women in Lingarth, which is 2 minutes' walk from the underpass. They also want to trace a group of lads seen by a phone box near Paston Ridings. If you've any idea who's responsible, please ring now. Police have the DNA of the offender and they can eliminate anyone who's innocent from the inquiry. It's a terrible crime, and one that may well be repeated until he's caught. The incident room number is 01733 424242.
Let me tell you, the calls on Davinola Taylor from the North Peckham estate are simply fantastic, and they're still coming in. They're giving names and really important ones. On the Sarah Payne case, we've almost certainly identified the curtain material is coming from Boots. We might even have identified where these particular curtains came from. And on Landarcy, absolutely beyond our dreams, the stuff that's coming in.
In 1981, 13 people died in a terrible fire at a birthday celebration in New Cross in South London. All the victims were black, and it was thought the fire could have been a racist attack. Now, on the 20th anniversary, the Met Police are making a fresh appeal. They want to trace everyone who was at that party, and they've put up the biggest ever reward. Velvetina, your son, He was at that party and he died because he was at that party.
Yes.
Just tell us a little bit about him.
Well, he left the house and go and play the party for his best friend's sister. Yvonne was Robert's sister. And he set his music, he and his other friends. And he came home at 12 o'clock to change, have a shower, change, bring his two friends with him. And then they went back at 1 o'clock in the morning. And he came and said good night to me before he left. That was the last time I saw my son, until 6 o'clock in the morning when my husband get the phone call. We didn't have time to say goodbye properly to him. We missed him very much.
I'm sure you did.
We all loved him very much, brothers and sisters.
And Nerissa, of course, your son died as well in the fire. And just to add to the tragedy, his girlfriend was pregnant at the time.
Yes, she was. But he never lived to see his daughter. She's such a lovely girl. And she gets upset very much when you speak about it.
And how, it's 20 years now, what would it mean to you to get this resolved now, to find out who did it?
Well, it would mean a lot, not to me alone, but to the families that lose their children. Because I'm sure we all love our children. And I don't think, well, we'll never rest until we know the truth.
Well, we're here tonight to see if we can find the truth. Magnus, the black community and the press criticised the police at the time of the initial investigation. Now with this much more recent investigation, why should people come forward now?
We think now there's a real possibility for progress in this case. People who assisted the investigation in 1981, we'd ask them to think again about what they said. Is there anything more they could add? Or people perhaps who didn't, for reasons to do with friendship or loyalties, share information with us, begin to think again about that and come forward, contact the Crime Watch control room for information.
And what do you know about how the fire started now?
All the tests now indicate the fire started within the house. A deliberate act, probably. Possibly a lighted match or cigarette lighter held against an armchair in the ground floor front lounge. And from there it spread throughout the house.
And you want to talk to anyone who may have seen what was going on or who may have heard about someone possibly plotting to do this?
Well, we're interested in what people can add to what we already know. And we'd say to people, think again about what you've already told us. If you think you can add some more that will build on the evidence that we've got, then we'd welcome that. And we'd ask people to have the confidence to come forward and share that with us.
OK, Magnus. You know, I remember this so well because I was at school just down the road from where this happened, and every day I'd go past on the bus and see that burnt-out house. And it was just a terrible sight. Please call in if you can help. The police need to hear from you. Call 020 8247 5200.
It's been a year since we appealed about Operation Eagle, Britain's longest-running inquiry to find a serial rapist. It remains a big investigation centred on Bath and Bristol, and they now have DNA. In fact, tonight, the appeal is nationwide.
The attacks began in Bath in 1991. And the last reported was early 1999.
Move over.
He put a blindfold over my eyes. I didn't know what was going on. I was so scared, so frightened.
The man attacks women in or around their cars.
Oh, shut up!
He strikes when it's dark, sometimes in the early evening, sometimes very late.
Take your safety belts off.
His initial attack is swift, usually demanding money.
Don't move or slash your face.
And he always threatens violence. He often drives his victims at knife point in their own cars, once from Kingswood in Bristol, but usually from around Bathwick. His fetish is tearing the crotch from his victim's tights, and if she isn't wearing tights, he produces a pair himself.
Put these on. Be careful, don't grip them.
He takes his victim towards the south of Bath and seems to know the area well, including little villages and lanes. Just before Christmas, the police circulated 40,000 of these leaflets to people in Bath, and tonight, through Crimewatch, the questions are going nationwide. Can you match the following to anyone you know? A slim white man between 30 and 50 who's a good driver, someone who knows Bath well, including the back lanes and walkways, and may have some connection with Kingswood in Bristol. If you said yes to all of that, can you also link at least two of the following? Firstly, a man who has a tights fetish, maybe during sex. He may even tear the tights. Secondly, he used to own a Batman Forever baseball cap. And thirdly, someone who's been out of the house in the evening or early hours, and you've had suspicions about where he's been.
Stay in the car for 5 minutes, and don't call the police, or I'll burn your house down.
After each rape, the man drives his victims back to where he picked them up, perhaps because he has his own car parked nearby. In fact, we now know that after a failed attack in January 1999, a man was seen running from the scene. And shortly afterwards, a vehicle was seen driving rapidly away. It was a silver four-door saloon with tinted or darkened windows. So who do you know who fits the earlier description and also 2 years back had a silver four-door saloon?
Bill, tell us about the clothing you brought in. Firstly, this pair of blue serge trousers, workman's trousers.
Yes,
basically.
These were wear-type trousers, I believe, were worn by the rapist. He may keep them in his car. They're issued by large companies to employees. What we'd like to do is add the trousers to the 8 other factors. If someone suspects someone and 8 or more factors apply, please call us now with the name.
And the cap, we know that one of these Batman caps was left at the scene of one of the raids.
Yes, it may be a coincidence, but 4 men and a woman in her 50s actually called at the photographic counter in Boots Southgate in Bath, inquiring for a lost cap similar to this.
This is January 1999?
January 1999. If you were one of those people, please call us now. We need to eliminate you from our inquiry.
OK, just call. We need to eliminate you. And indeed, we need to eliminate any clues about any people at all. Remember, there's DNA on this. Once again, it's a case where any suspect can be moved out of the inquiry very quickly if it's not the culprit. Please call us, 0500 600 600 here in the studio. It's also a free phone number direct to the incident room, 0800 169 1926.
How callous do you have to be to rob a pensioner of her life savings and leave her with nothing? I can't tell you how much satisfaction it would give me to catch this man.
Yes, I've tried that. This morning. Oh, right, thank you.
Oh, hello there.
You're the gas man. It's the radiator in the bathroom is not working up there.
It is cold. I'll need to see your heating system.
Oh, through here.
Well, your thermostat's broken. You're going to need a new one.
I'll be covered on my gas insurance for this, won't I?
Your insurance won't cover you for problems like this, I'm afraid. Yeah, how much is a new thermostat? OK. Cheers, mate.
How much is it going to cost me, then?
£250.
What?
I'll have to go to Newport to get a replacement. And I'll need the money in cash.
What sort of company expects that amount in cash?
Company rules, I'm afraid.
Well, I don't have that sort of money in the house.
I could give you a lift to the bank, if you like.
What about a cheque, then?
Sorry.
Oh. Well, you'll just have to take me to Rabina.
OK. Not a problem.
The man drove a white transit-style van. He didn't stop outside the bank in Rabina, but drove further down a residential street.
When you could have parked a lot closer. It's a long way for me to walk.
Cheers. I'll go into Newport, be back in the afternoon.
Good afternoon, British Gas. Come to check your radiators for you.
The conman had struck lucky. He was between 5'7" and 5'10" tall, of medium build with brown hair and a slight moustache. He was wearing blue clothing with an identification badge. 9 days later, police believe the same man struck again. This time, he had an accomplice.
The night before, it was terrible. Very wet and very windy.
Hello there. I've been doing some work on a roof up the road.
and I couldn't help but notice you've got a few tiles off your roof. I could do the work for you.
How much would that cost me?
Well, it's going to be about £400.
That's a bit excessive, isn't it? Could you do a check first?
Yeah, right.
The second man was blonde, slim, 6 foot tall, early 30s, wearing a blue boiler suit, baseball cap, and also had an identification badge. Again, a white van was used. This time it had a sign saying Apex Roofing and Building. Have you seen this van?
We've done the repairs. We just need to get up into the roof to check them.
But I didn't ask you to do the repairs. I asked you just to check them. So how much is that going to cost me?
Well, I can't do it for less than 180.
Oh, all right then, all right.
I'm not a foolish person, I hope not, anyway. I thought they were honest, and I thought they were proper working people.
Oh, you've left muddy footsteps on my carpet.
Oh, yeah. Have you got some newspaper to clean up the mess?
Oh,
they must have been very cool people. Very cool, and they must have done it before.
Oh, cheers. Would it be possible to have the payment now?
They were so calm. I can't believe how calm they were.
I'd like a receipt.
Oh, you don't have to worry about that. We can write the receipt out in the van.
Oh, yeah.
It happened so quickly. It was like lightning. I can't believe how quick it happened. I knew something had happened. These princes, they were in the bedroom. Why should they want to go across the bedroom?
They had found and taken her life savings of £16,000.
Well, they were very unfair, weren't they, to have done that after I had paid them that £180. I think that would have satisfied them, wouldn't you? But I feel very sad about that happening. I refuse to answer the door, maybe. That would be the best.
Let me tell you, that lady had been in domestic service since she was 15. And it had taken her 55 years to save that £16,000. What can you say? Call 02920 774237. And if you want to speak confidentially to Victim Support Line, the number's 0845 30 30 900.
So many calls from North Peckham Estate about Damalola Taylor. 8 naming the same group of people. Please keep those calls coming. And if you're a friend or family of one of those involved, for heaven's sake, get them to call themselves and sort this out. Next Crime Watch is on Wednesday, the very last day of February.
And there are more numbers on CFAX on page 61. And we still have calls coming in with more clues and more names. So come back at 11:05 for Crime Watch Update.
Join us then. A closing word on the latest crime statistics. The apparent rise in violent crime is almost certainly due to more reporting of crime and a good deal more minor offences, certainly much more minor offences than the sort of things that we show you here on Crime Watch. So don't have nightmares. Sleep well. Good night.
Good night.